morning, everyone. First of all, thank you so much for joining this session. There's always that internal fear that you're going to be the only one present in your session. So thank you. And then also thank you for coming. I know that there was a lot of debate on whether the event should go on, and there's other events that have canceled, and there's other considerations. So it's always encouraging to get together and share and learn. So thank you. The session that I have today is about five things you need to know when starting a data science practice in a non-digitally native organization. And this I've been part of Steelcase for a while now, and we'll go through it more formally. I just want to tee it off by introducing what I'm going to say. In case you feel it's absolutely boring, then I give you enough time to walk out and enjoy another session. Just kidding. But the idea here is that Steelcase is not necessarily an Uber, a Google, an Apple, a Microsoft when it comes to their soul and the way they came to be. And so there's different challenges and different ways to go about doing data science. And we've had quite an awesome journey. It has not been easy. And so I've always been an advocate for sharing what our learnings are and get your feedbacks, get your questions. So with that, let me start by introducing myself. I've been practicing data science for about a little over 8 years. Maybe before it was called data science, maybe it wasn't data science, but it sounds better to put more years under the practicing data science argument. I did my undergrad in economics at Monterrey, Mexico. That's my hometown. And then I did my graduate degree in actuarial science in Iowa. Go Hawks. They made it to the big the March Madness, I hope. But anyway, at some point I even did for actuarial science practices, you do all these preliminary tests, and they're pretty tough. I finished five of them, but didn't really want to pursue a formal career in actuarial science. In fact, I came back to Steelcase, and I joined the advanced analytics team. I was part of the advanced analytics team until recently, that it split into another team that is called the applied data science team, and I currently lead that team. And so let me talk a little bit more of some of the things that we've been working on. So the argument here is, what does a data scientist do? And we get that asked a lot, not just by people inside a Steelcase, but also outside, moms and grandmas and aunts and everyone. And so the truth is, it really depends where you work, right? And the argument here, we've been on so many conferences such as these, or analytics consortiums where leaders get together. And what really bonds people in their journey and where their journey is at from a data science perspective isn't really the size of the organization as much, but where they are in their digital transformation journey and whether they are a digitally native organization or not. So the truth is that everyone will have to be digital eventually, and there's over half of the Fortune 1000 companies that aren't really there yet. So there's a big opportunity, and a big opportunity to understand how to propagate the data science practices in organizations such as this. So what is digitally native? What is non-digitally native? It's somewhat intuitive, but the idea is that there's organizations that were built through data, in that their operating model all around revolves around data, and their customer experience revolves around the use of data. So the way they think about data is so much different. And there's other organizations that weren't necessarily born like that. They have a physical product or something different. And data is just something that needed to be carried along so that they could run their business. But the mindset of what that data would bring to them was different. It was more like a necessary evil, or something that was kind of needed to make sure that we bought things that we needed to make stuff to sell it. So really, one of the things that I've been learning is that a lot of what you end up doing as a data scientist depends on how far an organization is on their digital transformation journey, how fast an organization is moving on their digital transformation journey, and the degree of digital dexterity across an organization. So five things you need to know. I'm gonna talk about some things that I've learned by doing data science at Steelcase. For those of you that are not very familiar with Steelcase, Steelcase is based in Grand Rapids. We do office furniture. Steelcase was founded in 1912, I believe, so very old company. There's certain programs and data that I think might have been created in 1912 based on how they perform. So we have a lot of challenges in a lot of legacy systems and sometimes even legacy mindsets, right? And all of that is clashing with this trend of being digital and not only digitalizing the way we do business, but the way we engage customers and we produce experiences. So some of the things that I face a lot is people don't really know what to do with this skill set. If they just hand a data scientist to a marketing manager, they don't know whether we're there to make a couple of pie charts in Excel or build a robot. And the truth is it's somewhere in between, right? Some teams aren't necessarily ready to have a data science project, either because the mindset is not there, their systems aren't ready for it, or data might not be there, or it might not be a very compelling case that would justify the investment in having a data science team for a data science person or team for that part of the organization. We see a lot that businesses don't want to be disrupted. They just don't want to be bothered. They want to keep doing the things that they're doing. And then another thing that is so important is that legacy data also requires a transformation, and that is a huge burden for organizations that are now shifting gears towards digital transformation. And I'll give you a super fast example. Steelcase does office furniture. Let's say that we wanted to build a model that you snap a photo and it recognizes the chair and whether it's a Steelcase chair or not, or whether it's a competitor's chair or not, right? I mean, there's so many packages like that are available in things like Python and things that it is absolutely feasible. From a technical perspective, that is not, it's not like putting a man on the moon by no means, right? If you have the right data though, right? So what would I need to build a model like that? Well, I could use some like transfer learning or any of these buzzwords and use whatever Google's made and then just train it a little bit more, but I would need, I don't know, thousands of photos of chairs, and each of those would need to be tagged. We don't think that way. We just, if I talk to a marketing manager and they kind of heard or saw a commercial about data science, they'd be like, well, you got a lot of photos online. Why don't you just like use those? Well, yeah, but it's not that simple, right? So those are some of the challenges with this legacy data situation. So let's start with the first one. Know your customer. Who is your customer? Who are you working for? How do you get to work together? And this was something that we needed to learn, because when we started as an advanced analytics team at Steelcase, it was like, we're gonna create a team. Now you guys go find some interesting projects to do and save us a few million bucks. Go. And I mean, truth be told, it doesn't really work that way, right? We ended up just working on things that we found particularly interesting and challenging for us, but our ability to really connect to the business was very limited. So at some point we said, okay, let's do this lanes. Let's have a sales lane, a finance lane, an operations lane, a marketing lane, and there's gonna be one person that is gonna own that portfolio in a similar way that a sales rep would have a collection of customers, right? And what we do now is, okay, every quarter we get together, let's say that I am in charge of that marketing lane. So I'm gonna get together with the marketing VPs, with the marketing vice president and his direct reports, and I'm not just gonna tell them, what models do you need me to build? I'm gonna talk to them, what are your business objectives? What are you trying to accomplish? What are the pain point questions that are bugging you right now, aside from the coronavirus. And really make sure that we start with a business problem and allow those to feed our backlog rather than us starting with buzzwords like AI or deep learning or image recognition or text processing, right? No. That might be, but let's help me understand what are your business problems and how can we help you there, right? So point number two, and I really love this, keep it simple, but keep it creative. There is sometimes a misconception that a good data scientist is the one that can get a random forest from a 98% accuracy to a 99% accuracy. And maybe sometimes, especially when it involves like dealing with people's lives and stuff like that. When you're building furniture, it's not that critical. There are other things that are more vital. And one of the things that we found to be true, at least at Steelcase, is that the value of a data scientist will come from their ability to translate a business problem into a data problem that they can solve. And to be honest, some of the most successful projects that we've had at Steelcase, they aren't really that complicated. Like the modeling behind it is not extremely complicated. The complicated thing was understanding, how do I leverage the data environment? How do I tweak data? How do I create this metrics? And then how do I embed it in a way that will help them answer the questions that they need to answer to get their business done? And so I'm gonna talk about a few examples. When we do pricing at Steelcase, it is so complicated. It is more complicated than doing your taxes. We have all these different products and they all have these different discounts. And so a same product can have a 40% discount and the other product can have a 60% discount, but the margins are flipped. So it's just like, it's a strategy that the industry does to make sure that the products are bundled accordingly, that if we have a project that's five stories, like they're putting furniture on five floors, that we're more considerate on that than somebody that's just buying a chair for their living room and so on and so forth. So our ability to do analytics on pricing was hard, and we had to limit ourselves to just do them individually by product line. And when I started to get more involved in this, and I was like, well, why don't we just kind of like use Z-scores? Pricing director's like, what? Yeah, like if we just kind of translate them, put percentiles, and then like you can kind of aggregate them and you can get a feel for whether you're more aggressive on the chair or on the table. And maybe the actual discount for the table is higher, but compared to how you usually price it, it's not as aggressive as what you're doing on the chair. Everyone was mind blown, right? And so this wasn't transformational in terms of that guy's going to get a Nobel Prize and whatever the name of the most prestigious math award is. But the reality is we were able to look at data differently, and we were able to translate a business problem into a data problem. Another example that we have is we have special orders. Somebody that wants a table that's just a little bit bigger than what we usually do, or with a hole in the middle and things like that. And so how should we upcharge these custom orders? And will that upcharge be enough to reach my margin goals? Some of the things that were happening was that when we chose to say, oh, if you want that just a little bit bigger, it's gonna be $100 more. And we were really missing what the real number should have been. And so we had millions of dollars worth of losses because of our inability to accurately upcharge what we needed. And so we did two things. First, we said, well, what is your margin target? If you want to make, and I'm going to make this number up, 20% margin on this product, I'm going to not predict the upcharge. I'm going to predict how much it's going to cost to make. And then I'll do like this, I'll go backwards and determine what the price should be. And thus the difference should be this, right? And so if I would have done a model that just tries to predict the upcharge, it would have been so hard. But doing a model that predicts how much it's going to cost was so much easier. And then it was good, but it wasn't good enough in a sense that we could automate it. But We could tell very accurately when you were upcharging something that was very likely to lead to non-profitable sales. So that was an emergency because like we were losing money, so how could we at least close the faucet? And so doing a model that rather than saying it's gonna be $75.32, if I do a model that just says it's not gonna make any money or it might make money, it's so much easier problem. And so by flipping that, we were able to address a problem that will save us millions. And maybe we don't have the data ready to automate this experience where we automatically kind of predict the cost and send it off to the customer. But hey, at least we're doing something that's pretty important. Another thing that I wanted to talk about is the way we handle our product configurations. When somebody picks a piece of furniture, they can choose all these options about it. The height, the width, the depth, and let's think of a file cabinet. It can be one file height, two, three, five. It can have hinge doors, sliding doors, it can have, and it's usually just one product name, and then they specify how they want it. And so us doing analytics around that was so hard because no one really understood how to aggregate all the what we call finishes and options that the customer expect. If we kind of just did a join, we have this very long data set that is not really comparable because one line is one finish and you can't really compare a height with a depth or the finish at the top. And if I choose to flip it in a way that every row is how one product was configured, then I'm talking about thousands of columns. And you can't do that in Excel, you can't do it in Tableau. And so we were asked, like, how do I understand which products were configured similarly? They don't need to be identical, they just need to be similar. And so what we did is we said, well, maybe if I have those 1,000 columns and I create a lower dimensional representation of the data, which is a very fancy way of saying, I'm just gonna shrink it a little bit and create a funnel, basically that's what we're doing. I can't just look, what we did is we brought it down to about 10 columns instead of the 250 that we had for that particular product. But I can't just look at those columns and be like, yep, I know how this was spec'd, right? Because that transformation now makes it coordinates, right? But because they're coordinates, I can probably kind of just measure the distance, right? And understand which ones are more similar than others. And then later I can tackle the problem of identifying what makes them similar, but at least I know these two were very similar, right? And so this that you see here is actually a two-dimensional representation of the data. We kind of used 10 because it held a little more information, but you can see how organically each dot is basically a particular bookshelf that was configured in a certain way. All of these were configured very similarly, maybe like the little handles or something was different, but all in all, it was likely the same size, the same finish, the same height, etc. Right? So, cool, graph is cool, so thank you. Now what? Well, instead of having to look at each of the product configurations individually, we created clusters, very simple clustering algorithm. But now, instead of having to understand all of these individually, now they're team green. Instead of having to understand all of these individually, team yellow, right? And by doing that, it allows me to be able to narrow down my scope to focus on the questions that I'm trying to answer. So what we did is, all right, let's plot our margin. Each of these bubbles here is one of the groups that we created. So, all right, these are the bad boys. Let's focus on those, right? Rather than just trying to understand the universe of how people configure things, let's understand what we can do about those, right? Are we not pricing them accordingly? Do we need to do something about the way they've been built? And so those kind of things have been so powerful. None of those things, again, are extremely challenging from a mathematical perspective. But it's what the organization needs to gain traction and gain trust of how to leverage data. Things like confidence intervals, linear models, k-mean clustering, basic probability distributions, I mean, those are not dead at all in the world that we live in. In fact, some of them just prove to be so much more effective in our ability to just gain traction and answer questions in a way that are direct and effective and good enough. It doesn't have to be perfect to be excellent. This book I love. If for anyone that is coming from like a computer science background and kind of want to understand more how to apply these models, or for anyone that is managing a data science team and doesn't really know much about data science, it is super well written, very easy to understand, and it's just like the basic toolkit that a data scientist needs to know. Things like prediction models, supervised, unsupervised learning. Great book, and there's a free online course, and you get a diploma that says Stanford on it. Some people might not know that it's not really Stanford, but who cares? It says Stanford. So in reality, it's not really about building the most accurate or complex model. It's about creative solutions that enable new capabilities and ways to use the data. So let's talk about point number three. Those who tell the best stories rule the world, and I think we all agree on that, right? It is so critical for the data science team to learn how to do this. People respond more to stories than any other narrative, and we know that. So the more we take the time to frame back to our customer, and when I say customer, I don't mean the people that we sell the furniture to, I see it from a data science lens, so the marketing leader, right? What was the business problem that we were after? Why was it a main challenge? Why is it important? I wanna tell it back to you why I feel it's important to you. How are we thinking about the problem? What's the main insight? And what are the decisions that may result from this insight? But one of the most important things that I've proven to be very successful for us is the mentality of, I'm not gonna tell you, I'm gonna show you, right? And so if when you're having a conversation, you spend your time trying to say, here's what my game plan is gonna be, and I'm gonna do this transformation, like dimensional reduction, and I'm gonna put all these crazy colored looking bubbles and things like that. It's overwhelming for them. They don't understand why the journey is important. But if you say, let me get back to you, I think I have a few thoughts, and you come back with the plot and say, this is what I believe we should focus on. And this is kind of what I did. Few things we need to decide. I used 100 clusters. The more clusters you have, the more granular the groups are, the less it makes it easier to understand. So we just need to talk about how many clusters we want, and that's important. Let's look at a few examples. If you see things that are not meant to be compared, then we gotta go deeper. But if you feel we're good with that, then I think you can use this to start making decisions about how to price stuff differently. And so, showing rather than telling, right? This is an example of how the show rather than tell mentality was a game changer for us. And so Steelcase has a part of their business that focuses on IoT, not just industrial Internet of Things, but just the regular IoT. We put sensors in spaces to allow our customers to understand how they're using their spaces and how much. And we anonymize, take care of all the privacy, security, and all of that, and then store the data on these massive data lakes, which happen to be Azure. I'm just saying that because Janet from Microsoft is here, and we want to look good. But anyway, we stored those, and we didn't really understand what to do with them. We just knew that we kind of had to store them, right? And then for the longest time, nothing was done. We approached the problem and we said, well, sales aren't that great on this product, but it's because what we're doing is we're creating all these data, we're creating all these visuals, then sending them off to the customer and be like, that's what you need to know, good luck, right? And so the hypothesis is, we know this is valuable, we know this information is valuable. In the same way that we all agree here that an airplane is a very valuable tool. But if I gave you an airplane right now, just the airplane, in theory, you could use it to fly wherever you want to, go to Paris or Hawaii or whatever, right? But in reality, I don't know how to operate an airplane. I couldn't even get that thing to turn on, right? So without some guidance, without a pilot, that thing is useless for me, right? And so we started to understand that that was happening. Data was useless because they did not know how to navigate through it. So we said, let's create a story out of that. What are the questions that they are trying to answer? They're trying to answer, do I have enough meeting rooms? Do I have space to fit more people? How often are my mobile workers there? What are some of the patterns that I can see with my resident workers? Do I have the right type of workstations? And so rather than sending something and assuming they'll be able to navigate that, if we focus on answering those questions and allowing them to, the opportunity to dive as deep as they want, but be brought back up and say, here's the answer to some questions that we know are important for you, then man, that experience for them is so different. Again, all the math behind it on how we get to answer those questions is not nuclear science, right? But it's just about thinking differently of how to present that. What's the story behind it? Number four, you will fail before you succeed, and that is okay. And man, have we failed terribly at Steelcase, right? We had an example, before I move to the example, why are some of the reasons that we failed? Well, this is the most common one, the one we love, because it kind of puts us off the hook. Oh man, totally, I could have done that, absolutely, but we don't have enough data, so it's just like, but I mean, if you talk to me and you ask me, can you do it? Absolutely, it's just, yeah. But there's also sometimes that there's just not enough business engagement. We can't really figure out how to embed the solution into the business, into the tools that they use. But more often than not, you will find that the reason why data science initiatives fail is because we try to solve the wrong question. Let me give you a quick example. We had this project that started as customer churn. We were trying to predict when a customer was getting ready to leave us. If you are Netflix or AT&T or DirecTV, that problem makes so much sense because it's a subscription model. Steelcase doesn't really have a subscription model. We're a lot of project-based, right? And so we tried so hard to force a model, like a mathematical approach to create something for just something that wasn't really part of our business. Because our idea was, okay, when are our customers leaving us? That's the focus of our question, when are our customers? And I mean, that project led me to have one of the most awkward meetings with a senior executive that I've ever had in my life. He literally walked out of the room. And I mean, in hindsight, we kind of deserved it, but at that point I was extremely offended and emotional. But that problem was approached later and said, well, we do need to know information about our customers. But rather than trying to say, when are they getting ready to leave us, what if we, based on our understanding of when they last bought office furniture, what if we could predict when they're getting ready to buy again, right? Regardless of whether they bought from us or anyone else, right? If we understand the cadence that companies have of refreshing their stack, of growing, of upgrading, maybe we can build a model that predicts that based on the size of the customer, the vertical market, where they're located. And that was this project over here. That's been one of the most successful data science initiatives that we've had. We're able to tie over $150 million to that initiative. I mean, the model itself doesn't really do the selling, so it would be unfair to the salespeople that actually do sell it. But I mean, in this industry, being early in the game is so important. And if you know with enough insight what's gonna happen, you're able to strategize. Another thing that I want to talk is, yes, you will succeed. If you hedge your bets a little bit, you can minimize the, I don't want to call it embarrassment, but the risk associated with having projects that don't pan out. And you can do that by keeping a healthy mix of projects that balance either this moonshot approach or low-hanging fruit. Moonshot, I'm gonna do an app and it's gonna do this and then customers are gonna, or low-hanging fruit approach of like, I'm just gonna help you understand this question that you need to answer, right? And within those, you might wanna think, do I have enough data right now or do I need to think differently about data? You might also think, is this something that is absolutely critical for us, regardless of whether there's data or not? And keeping a balance here and being open with your stakeholders of why you've chosen your backlog the way it is can help you. Maybe some of them aren't moving as fast, but it's because they are falling here and your business partner needs to understand that versus something that is here and your business partner might also need to be receptive and understanding of that. And so we do that a lot. I always want to make sure that the team has a good balance of that and that we communicate that we're intentional, because if we're just filled with these, it's tough. It's tough because it's high risk for us. There's no closure for the data scientist or for the business partner, so it just feels like it's taking forever and nobody's doing anything, right? But if we only do this, are we really changing the organization? So it's challenging, but we wanna make sure that we keep that balance. Number five, and I love this one, you don't need a data scientist, you need a data science team, and it's a huge difference. What is the difference? Well, a successful practice of data science in an organization requires a mix of skills and personas, personalities. And if you believe that a single individual can handle that is risky, right? I'm sure there's individuals that have the full stack from start to finish, and if you find five of those, it's awesome. West Michigan is a little bit hard. So rather than doing that, if we define what are the things that we need to have an effective team, and you identify personas that can bring those values and that can fill those gaps, it's so much more effective. You need somebody that can help you lead the portfolio, define and scope, understand that matrix of projects, and understand which ones go where. Somebody that's very intimate with the business, but also with the data environments, and that if you spit out a couple of models and algorithms, he'll kind of know what you're talking about. You also need people that know how to build pipelines, people that know how to containerize models, people that know how to deploy them, how to create a simple user interface, right? How to train something in the background, how to schedule it to run on the weekend so that you don't have to worry about it, and Monday morning everything is fresh and your morning is awesome. You also need machine learning engineers, people that will be able to take the challenge if you need a model to get from 98 to 99 because it's business critical, people that might be able to use some of the more advanced and sophisticated algorithms like deep learning, leverage natural language processing. They're just so much more comfortable with that. But they're, in my team at least, I don't hold them accountable to define the business problems. I hold them accountable to make the model work, to frame it, to get to a certain degree of service level agreement that we can introduce in like accuracy or things like that, right? And you need lead modelers, people that are very good at connecting with somebody from the business, understanding their problem and translating it into a data problem. And maybe they get it so far, but I don't need this person to know how to do production ready Python code. I need this person to understand what the solution looks like and what it will bring. And I will have people that know how to build Python code that's production ready. Or maybe it's not Python, maybe it's C++. I don't need this guy to know that. I don't want to freak him out. But to them, it's their bread and butter. How do they interact with the team, with the organization? Well, we have this data science team, and we have data scientists, and we have data engineers. We have a business process owner and a business systems owner. And let's talk about the sales organization as an example. We have the regional manager, right? And he needs to understand who their customers are, when we need to approach, what we need to sell to them, what's our pricing, right? And so he's talking with the data scientists to make sure that we are building models to help them. And with the data engineer, the conversation here is like, all right, we need to build something that when they open their dashboard, they get all these recommendations and the pricing and these projects, and it needs to happen all in the same place, and it needs to change whatever, whatever. And so I'm building all the models for that. I need you to help me deploy them. Oh, and by the way, the system that they use is X, and so we need to do whatever. So the data engineer is going to talk. Okay, so where are we getting information from our customers? Well, they're here. Where are we getting information from our pricing? Well, they're here. Okay, how do I first link those together, make them available for modeling, but then understand how am I going to push this out into a platform or a program that the sales user will leverage? Because if I just push out a CSV file and then send it by email, which is my favorite thing to do, it never gains traction, right? So five things you need to know. Know your customer. Keep it safe, but keep it creative. Keep it simple, sorry. Also safe, but keep it simple, but creative. Those who tell the best stories rule the world. Don't tell, show, right? You will fail before you succeed, and that's okay. Good way to work around that is having a healthy portfolio that manages projects based on just how complicated and easy. And you don't need a data scientist, you need a data science team. And that'll make things much easier for everyone in that team. And it will really augment your ability to deliver from front to finish. Now, these are the things that I've experienced at Steelcase and that have been super helpful. I'm not necessarily implying that this is the holy grail. And I'm pretty sure that it will be very intimate and very personal based on your company, your culture, your needs. But I at least hope that these anecdotes or points of advice help you in any way or spark some ideas on how to work with your organization on building a data science team. Feel free to reach out, jlozano1@steelcase.com. I am super social. I try not to be awkward. More than happy to jump on a call, exchange emails, either at Steelcase or LinkedIn. And again, thank you everyone for the time and for being here. Yes, I would love to take any questions if any. Sure. Yes, absolutely. So the question is, how do I understand if it's a strategic approach or a data approach? How does that work at Steelcase? And I have a great example. We have a lot of information around the manufacturing, how the products go through certain plants. We call it like the routing. And we hadn't really thought of ways to leverage it. We have so much data. Hadn't thought of ways to leverage it. So we said, you know what? I think there's a real opportunity here in operations to leverage the data to better understand our manufacturing process. That is something that we know data isn't going to be our problem, is figuring out how to get value out of the data that was going to be more of the problem. But it was still something that was really important. Now, another thing, completely different problem, is our ability to understand how our products are coming together to form a solution for our customer, believe it or not, is very limited. Think of it this way. We know how many individual Lego pieces we sell and which, how many of them are like the six circle dot versus the whatever, but we don't know what Lego sets we sell. And that to us is so important. And we've tried to crack the code, but at some point we said, you know what, this is critical, and we don't really have the right data, let's change that. What do we need? All right, if for the drawings that our customers are using, we can extract the coordinates of the products that they're ordering, we can practically map those, understand adjacencies, understand how they're coming together. We had to create a pipeline to be be able to also ingest those. Now, do we have 15 years worth of historical data on product coordinates? No. But it's something that is so important that we focused on getting the right data to build that capability. Does that make sense? Yes. Yeah, that's an awesome question. I feel you. I have a great example. And I don't know if I'm oversharing, but there's nobody here from our competitors, and my boss isn't here, so who cares? last week, one of the VPs issued us a note and said, hey, there's all these companies that are sending their employees home to work from home. I bet if we make a list of those and we know who our customers are, we can approach them and be like, hey, your employee's working from home. I bet he'd appreciate if he had like a nice chair, a good desk, a monitor arm. Maybe we can target them, right? And so can you build me this thing that just kind of like scraps the web and then aligns it with our customers and then says which ones are the highest? Sure, sounds awesome. When do you need it by? 3 days. I'm like, yeah. Let me get back to you. So what we did is we said, okay, we could use Google Alerts to find relevant news headlines of the talk about companies that are sending their employees home. And we can package those, put them nicely, and send them off and say, here's what's new about companies that are sending their employees home. We can get that to you in 2 days, no problem, and it'll automate overnight, so you can get that file, or we can put it on a dashboard and you'll be able to see it fresh. If we want to take it to the next level, it'll take me more time. And here's what that next level would be. If you want like the prime version, it'll take me that much time, and here's what that would be. And then they get a good feel for like, okay, it's not that they can't, it's just that I need to understand how long it would take. And so maybe they're comfortable with the first one, maybe they're like, get me the first one and let's work on the second one, and I'm willing to wait. And so that type of negotiation has been successful in other situations. Does that help? It doesn't help, but I hope I answered your question. Anyone else? All right. Well, thank you again. Feel free to reach out. And again, thank you for being here.